This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Topic: Mary Regan. Author: Leroy Scott. Chapter 1: The World Sits Down Together. It was opening night of the new bill at the Grand Alcazar, and Clifford, as he waited alone at a little table for his host, almost unconsciously searched through the great restaurant of black and gold for Mary Regan, just as almost unconsciously he had been seeking her wherever he had been during the 6 months of agreed-upon silence since they had parted. He did not expect to see her here, hence felt no disappointment when his roving eyes did not come upon her. She had said she would write when she had thought it all out, and when she was ready to see him. 6 months was a long time, but he believed in her word, and still waited, not once having sought to penetrate that utter privacy which she had asserted to be for her at that time life's prime essential. But though keeping his word, he had often been impatient, and had often wondered. Meditatively, Clifford glanced over this great crowd of well-dressed diners. For him they were a vivid concentration, a cross-section of life. Of life as he, in his philosophy and in the pursuit of his profession, had come to see it. Here were millionaires, many of them having made their easeful fortunes by dubious operations which shrewd counsel had steered just within the law. Here were young men of moderate means, spending recklessly. Here were society women of the younger and smarter set, with their escorts, sowing the seeds, though they dreamed it not, of possible scandal and possible blackmail. Here were members of that breed of humans who are known as sporting men. Here were the most finished types of professional crooks, many accompanied by the finished women of their own kind, but here and there with them a girl who had no idea of the manner of man with whom she ate and drank, and no idea of the end of this her pleasant adventure. And here were respectable mothers and their daughters, who were innocent of what sat at the next table. And here were out-of-town visitors who were visibly excited and exalted by the thought that they were seeing life, New York, the real New York. Clifford smiled sadly, rather grimly to himself. These conglomerate guests were proof of what he had long held, that there was no distinct underworld, no distinct upper world, that in ideas and personalities the two were always merging. This scene summarized what experience had made the basic idea of Clifford's working philosophy. The great interrelation, the great interdependence, the great oneness of all humanity. Looking over this mixture of all sorts, in which acquaintance was so easy to make, Clifford thought of the strange dramas that had their beginnings in the Grand Alcazar and establishments of its kind. Thus much had the dancing craze, though now receded from its earliest frenzy, and the practice of dining and eating midnight suppers in the showy restaurants, achieved. It had brought all sorts of persons, so long as they were well-dressed, under the same roof, and had set them down at the same or adjoining tables. Hardly since time began had that important requisite of great drama been so nearly perfect as in these restaurants, for people of different ideas and interests and moral standards to meet naturally upon a common ground. A little man, swart of face, his mustache tightly waxed, and in the smartest evening dress that convention permits the male, paused and spoke to Clifford, a gentleman whom most of the patrons of the place knew if they knew him at all as Monsieur Labane. Though the master of this ornate pleasure palace, he spoke obsequiously. Clifford liked to see the great little man squirm. "Police trouble you much here?" he asked. "No, Bob. I never see a policeman here except when a captain or an inspector comes in to eat," the great restaurateur said nervously. "Not like the old days downtown, with their raids, eh, Joe?" "Nothing of that sort, ever." And with a quick look around that showed he feared someone might have overheard these sentences and guessed what lay behind them, he said something about being needed on his ballroom floor and hurried away. Clifford watched the famous restaurateur, again smiling grimly. If these people here, the respectable ones at least, knew the record of Joe Gordon, which again was not the name given him at birth, knew from what places and occupations he had made his way to his eminence of foremost host and impresario of prandial entertainment, what a panic there would be. Or would there be a panic? Life was certainly strange, with its emergencies, its juxtapositions, its crossing of threads, strange at least to him who was always seeing behind the scenes. Yes, life was certainly strange. Clifford's meditations were interrupted by a hearty, "Hello, Bob," and by a large hand gripping one of his. "Hello, Uncle George. I'd begun to think." "Hold on, son," and Clifford's host halted the talk by raising one hand like a traffic policeman and with the other reaching for the dinner card. While the long order was being dictated, Clifford gazed impatiently across at his companion, wondering what this appointment was about. His host was a large man who once might have been bulbous, but who now had deflated little balloons of skin hanging beneath eyes and chin and jaws. His few short gray hairs were divided into two precisely equal portions. His eyebrows were entirely gone, and of eyelashes he had almost none. His eyes were smallish, gray, cunning, genial. He made Clifford fancy with those eyes of his so good-naturedly cynical, and with his large, outstanding ears, that here might be a satyr who had forsaken gay forests for city, and had at length grown into grandfatherly days. "Well now, Uncle George, what's all this about?" Clifford demanded, when the order was in. "Not so fast, son, not so fast," slowly remonstrated Uncle George, who, as far as Broadway's knowledge went, was no one's Uncle George, but who was known by no other name. "Let's wait until we've packed away some of the freight that waiter's going to bring us." He blinked his lashless lids and drawled on. "It's been a long time since I've seen you, 6 months. I just wanted to give you the once-over and ask you how was trade?"
"Trade's good, considering."
The old head nodded.
"Yes, considering that you're a detective who's on the square. There's not much chance for that sort, son. Not in this here widely advertised Christian civilization of ours. At least, not much chance to make a large private collection of coin."
"I'm not in this primarily to make money. I thought you understood that."
"You sure are a queer guy, son," pronounced the old man. "I've heard you spiel off your ideas. You're not primarily a thief taker. You're in this to help people out of the trouble. A hell of an idea for a detective. You know as well as I do, Uncle George, that most of the people that get into trouble or seem to be bad, well, they personally are not so much to blame. They've been born and raised in bad conditions, they've never had a chance, have never really been able to tell what was right or wrong, and have never had a chance to choose the right."
"Come up for air, son, come up for air," cut in the old man.
"Son, that's nice music, but it's all bunk. You're an awful example of what a college education can do to a man. Now you just listen to your Uncle George. You know me, everybody knows me. I've been in about every crooked game known to the human race and the higher animals, including managing shows. And I've never been pinched because I was too clever for the coppers, and the coppers know it too. I tell you I know life up and down and across the middle, and I tell you that we've all got a streak of crookedness, every damned one of us."
"If that's so," smiled Clifford, "then why are you always helping crooks?"
"That's just my human cussedness. I've retired from business. I'm one of these gentleman farmers that have located on Broadway, but I don't like to see any earnest young crook get a raw deal from the coppers, who are the rawest crooks of all." The old man waved his left hand, as though brushing such conversation aside. "But let's get down to brass tacks, which means you and me. You and Bradley as great friends as ever?"
Despite himself, Clifford flushed with chagrin.
"Don't try to be funny.
And son, don't be too sore. Bradley was one hell of a guy. He was the cleverest chief of detectives the police department ever had.
And the crookedest."
"Sure, son. Didn't I tell you us humans were all crooks?" the old man said appeasingly. "But sure, there never was a crookeder chief of detectives than Bradley. You certainly showed nerve when you started out to get him, and you certainly showed your class when you finally trapped him, publicly, with the goods on. Only..."
"That's it, only," Clifford exclaimed, sourly.
"It's quite some little word, that only."
"Sure, only.
Son," and the old man spoke gravely, "I'm twice as old as you are, but you should know as well as I know that you really can't get a copper. I mean, a clever copper. Count the big coppers that have really been sent away, the smart boys I mean, and you'll see you have several fingers left to check up your laundry on. That was grand business you pulled on Bradley, and it showed all New York he was a crook. It was worth doing, God, yes.
But I said to myself, as soon as I heard of the swell arrest you had made of him, that a classy guy like Bradley would have himself covered and would beat the case when it came to trial. And he sure did beat it. On a technicality, Clifford was still bitter at the manner in which his old enemy and old superior officer had slipped from what had seemed the sure clutches of the law. A technicality, sure. But it got him off, and what more does a crook ever ask for? But he got reinstated in the police department. But didn't he retire right afterwards, claiming broken health? And don't you and I know his real reason was that his old game was done for, and that the public was wise to him? The big trouble with you, son, the old man declared severely, is that you want a 100% victory. The best you can hope for with a guy like Bradley is to split the thing 50-50. You seem to admire Bradley a lot, half growled Clifford. I do. I hand it to the guy with brains wherever I meet him. I don't see how you can be friends with me then. You're clever too, son. You're the only one I've ever figured might beat Bradley in a finish fight. And then you're a queer party, Bob, you're square, he drawled. I've traveled up and down this world of he and she grafters, shoplifters, safe blowers, and sure thing businessmen, and after it all, you know it's right pleasant to sit down in the shade of a square guy. And besides, son, he added, I said I admired Bradley because he was clever. I didn't say I liked him as a friend. Now you, Bob, somehow I like you. Thanks, Uncle George. There was a moment's silence. But that's not what you got me here to tell me. Perhaps not, son. But what's the hurry? Queer, ain't it? He meditated. How all the big cops, when they leave the police department, open a private detective agency. I hear Bradley's doing great business since he started out as a private detective. Licensed blackmailer, that's what he is. Sure, son, that's what they all are. A client tells a private sleuth secrets and retains him to get information about some other party and is held up for a big fee. The sleuth gets the information and then makes the second party pay by threatening to expose him, second hold up, and then makes the first client pay again by threatening to expose the original secret, third hold up. Oh, it's a rich game Bradley switched into. Once more, Uncle George, that's not what you got me here to tell me. Perhaps it's not really so much I've got to tell you. Maybe it's occurred to you, meditatively, slowly, that since the big upset you gave him, Bradley isn't exactly what you might call in love with you. Not exactly. Well, I heard it from a friend who's got a friend who's got a mother-in-law who listens to little birds, and the dope runs that Bradley is out to square matters with you. Clifford nodded. He had expected something of the sort. Did this little bird relay any information as to just what Bradley was going to do? None that got to me. But son, I'd keep my eyes pointed in all directions and be careful of the friends I made and be careful of the cases I got drawn into. It may be a long time coming, and God only knows in what direction it'll come from. Bradley knows how to handle people so they never know they're being handled, and he's likely to hit you through almost anyone. Look out, son. This is serious. There'll be big doings. Clifford gazed steadily at the old worldling. Indeed, there must be something in big, or else Uncle George, whose general attitude in matters of morals, police, and criminals was one of genial laissez-faire, would not have brought him this warning. He knew from experience the craft and power of Bradley, his subtle patience in working out his designs, his patience in waiting apparently quiescent for the right moment, the swiftness and might with which he struck when the instant came to strike. Automatically, swiftly, Clifford's mind flashed forward in search of possible weapons, of direct and devious schemes that the fertile-brained Bradley might be contriving against him. VVV. Chapter 2: The Return of Mary Regan. Suddenly, all conjectures concerning Bradley were swept utterly from his mind. Down the gilded red-carpeted stairway that led from what the Grand Alcazar termed its ballroom deluxe, there came, though this was not the figure Clifford first noted, a short, full-bodied, ornately dressed man with a bald crown and a smile of engaging amiability. Beside him and a half head taller, and this is what Clifford first saw, walked a slender young woman in an evening coat of rose velvet, her rounded throat gleaming a dusky marble from the soft shadows of the furred collar. Her face was the rose tan of early autumn leaves, and her dark eyes gazed straight before her with a composure so complete that it seemed to announce a haughty indifference to all the world. "Mary Regan?" ejaculated Clifford, stupefied. Uncle George seemed not the least startled by Clifford's exclamation. He turned, and then there was surprise enough in his voice. "Hello, Peter Loveman with her." Clifford, recovered from his brief paralysis, arose and hurried between the tables. But the pair had already turned into the entrance and did not note him. As Clifford came into the gilded and bepalmed lobby, he saw her, aided by four eager Grand Alcazar flunkies and by Loveman, looking a grotesquely small Grand Opera impresario in his silk hat and fur coat, stepping into a closed car. By running, Clifford could have caught her, or by calling, he could have gained her attention. But at that instant he remembered the essence of their bargain, that he should make no attempt to seek her out until she sent for him. That remembrance checked him. The door closed upon the rose velvet figure, the car slid off through Broadway's incandescent brilliance, and she was gone. Forgetful of where he was, Clifford stood bareheaded and stockstill in the lobby. Mary Regan's sudden reappearance out of the silence, the vacancy, of 6 months' absence, sent his mind flashing over the past, the present, the future, touching in chaotic wonderment the high spots of his strange relationship with her. Daughter of that one-time famous cynic and famous master criminal, Gentleman Jim Regan, dead these 5 years, she had passed her girlhood in the cynical philosophy of the little court surrounding her father, had made that philosophy her own, and grown into young womanhood, she had joined that great crime entrepreneur, her Uncle Joe Russell, in many of his more subtle enterprises. It was at the beginning of this career that Clifford's life had come into contact with hers. Police Commissioner Thorne had ordered him to cover the pair. From the first, Clifford had conceived the idea that her criminal point of view was not an expression of her true nature, but was a habit of mind developed in her by association. And he had proceeded upon the theory that a bigger role than merely to make arrests would be to arouse the real Mary Regan to her true self. The conflicts between the two, her hostility to him, his ultimate success or seeming success when he had broken through her shell of defensive cynicism, and last of all, that parting scene down in Washington Square in the dusk of the oncoming dawn. He lived through that scene for a briefest moment. He was always living over that scene. He had told her that he loved her, and she, admitting that she loved him, had said, "But that doesn't mean I can marry you." "Then what does it mean?" he had demanded. A look of decision had come into her face. How vividly he recalled every minutia of their one love scene, and she had said, "Before we can talk definitely about such things, I want to go off somewhere, alone, and think over what you have said about me. If I am not what I used to be, if I am really that different person you say I am, I want to get acquainted with myself. I seem so strange to myself, it all seems so strange. I hope you are right, but I must be sure, very sure. And so I am going away. But when you come back," he had cried. "A lot may happen before that," she had answered gravely. "A lot to you, and a lot to me. But when you come back," he had insisted. "When I come back," she had breathed quaveringly, "if you still think the same way about my being that sort of person, and if I find that it's really true." And then his arms had closed about her, and he had kissed her. But even as she had let him, she had murmured almost fearfully, "Remember, a lot may happen before then." Clifford's mind leapt forward from that long-gone night to the present. And now she was back, back out of the unknown into which she had disappeared, and back without having sent him a word of any kind. What did it mean, this unannounced return? And what did it mean, her being in company with dapper little Peter Loveman? Man about town, and carrying behind that round, amiable smile the shrewdest legal brain of its variety in New York. Clifford had in reality been standing in the gilded lobby for no more than a minute, though his mind had traversed so wide a space, when a gray and black town car, with a long hood that suggested power ample for a racer, slowed down at the curb, and a young man stepped out and hurried into the Grand Alcazar. Fifth Avenue tailors and hatters and haberdashers had equipped him with their best and costliest. "Sink my ship if it's not old Bob Clifford," he cried, giving Clifford a slender, soft hand. "How's the old boy?"
"Same as always."
"And how's Jackie Morton? You've been missing for months."
"I've a wonderful tale to unfold, but no time to unfold it now."
There was that about him which begot an instant liking, though his face was not as strong as it might have been.
"Say, you won't believe it, but listen. I've been on the wagon for 17 weeks."
"No.
Give you my word.
Not a drop in 17 ages.
Had to, you know.
My old man, say he's one old battleship, steamed into New York and shut off supplies and said unless I cut it all out and took a brace, there'd be no more shipments of munitions. Get the situation, don't you? Case of a 16-inch gun shoved into my face and being told it would go off if I didn't reform. So look and behold and observe what's happened, I'm reformed. Been off where milk's all they shove cross the bar, isolated and all that kind of thing, and been behaving in a way to make the Ten Commandments jealous. Honest to God, Clifford." Abruptly, he checked this effervescence.
"Say, seen Peter Loveman about here?"
"He's just gone."
"Alone?"
"I believe there was a young lady with him," Clifford replied discreetly, wondering a little what young Morton's business, if any, could be with the pair that had left. Morton hesitated, then again was effervescent.
"Was to have met him here, but there's no telling where he is.
Come on, let's have a drink."
"But you are on the wagon."
"I am. But I want to give you the grand sight of watching me fall off."
"You sit tight right where you are," advised Clifford.
"Now come on, don't block traffic with a funeral," pleaded the young fellow, slipping an arm through Clifford's.
"Just one drink."
Clifford shook his head, and Morton tried to draw him into the restaurant.
"Just one little drink, Clifford. One little drink after a Sahara of milk."
"Mr. Morton," a deep, brusque voice called from behind them. They turned. A man, square of shoulders and deep of chest, and with square, forceful face, was advancing toward them.
"Hello, Clifford," he said.
"Hello, Bradley," Clifford returned, trying to speak calmly. And for the briefest space, these old enemies who had so often been at grips stared at each other with hard, masked gazes. Bradley turned to Clifford's companion.
"So you tried to give me the slip, Mr. Morton.
I heard what you suggested to Clifford.
But I guess you are keeping off the booze tonight."
"Just look this large person over, Clifford," mourned the young fellow. "And honest ain't it hell my father wishing a party like Bradley on me for a nurse."
"You need one all right," Bradley said grimly.
"But even babies get let alone for an hour now and then," protested the other.
"You forget that the size of my check from your father depends upon my keeping you and booze apart."
Morton sighed.
"You're a sordid person, Bradley."
"I might mention incidentally," continued Bradley, "that your father has just come to town."
"The devil."
Morton's face filled with dismay.
"I guess then it really is good night, Clifford."
He took Bradley's arm.
"Come on, Nursie. Let's hail the captain of my perambulator."
Clifford watched the two go out, and again he had the sense that he was glimpsing into the complicated maze behind the brilliant surface of big pleasure. The relationship between that pair might be strange for any other period in the world's history, but it was a definite, though small, phase of this great pleasure life. A gay young spender bridled and the reins put in the hands of a private officer. Clifford felt a moment's uneasiness for young Morton. In what ways could Bradley not twist his client and protege into predicaments that would bring him profit? When Clifford regained his table, Uncle George regarded him with amazement.
"I thought you had gone."
"Gone where?"
"With or after Miss Regan."
"Why?"
"I thought you were, well, I guess you get me.
That being the case, I didn't think you'd pass up the chance to be with her."
Clifford hesitated, then spoke the truth. "The last time I saw Mary Regan, I promised not to speak to her until she sent for me."
"And it was your promise that stopped you?"
Uncle George asked incredulously.
"Yes."
"You poor simp."
I suppose you thought she'd be thinking of you, only you, with you out of her sight for 6 months, and that then there'd come a sweet little message like them they flash on the movie screens. Clifford did not reply. Uncle George had very nearly expressed his thought. No woman ever lived that could keep thinking of one man for 6 months and him away. Uncle George leaned closer and spoke in a low voice. See here, son. While you've been keeping your promise and remaining strictly off the premises, what do you think the other people have been doing?
What other people? Cried Clifford in quick alarm.
Uncle George ignored the question. You think you've been an influence upon her?
Maybe so, son. Maybe so.
But she was 20, and 2 or 3 more before you ever saw her. Don't you think those 20 years might have some influence with her too?
What other people? Repeated Clifford.
Again Uncle George ignored the question. He looked at Clifford keenly and spoke slowly.
While ago you asked me why I wanted to meet you here.
Well, son, my chief reason was because I knew Mary Regan was going to be here, and because I thought on seeing her, you'd wade right into the situation.
See here, George, what do you know?
Clifford cried sharply.
Mighty little, that's definite. And telling you that would be giving people away, and that's against my principles. And besides, the little I know might only be misleading.
But son, the old man's voice was grave, if you're at all interested in that girl, you sure ought to be busy. And that's all I can say.
Abruptly, Clifford stood up.
Thanks, Uncle George, goodbye, and he was gone.
VVV.
Chapter 3. Peter Loveman. Clifford's first business was to make up for the opportunity he had just let slip, and find Mary Regan. At once he decided that his best source of information was her brother, Slantface, once a pickpocket of amazing skill, now the manager of a little motion picture house. He turned uptown to Slantface's theater. On the way, he was feverishly alive with questions. Clifford's thoughts had really not been off Mary Regan from the moment he had seen her come down the stairway. And now Uncle George's vague warning. He knew Uncle George would not have spoken even so indefinitely unless there existed a very real situation, banished all else from his mind. Why hadn't Mary Regan sent him word? What was behind her return in such a manner? What decision had she come to in regard to herself during these months? What decision in regard to him? And this danger that Uncle George had hinted at, did it rise chiefly from the plans and influence of other persons? And who might these other persons be? And what might be the danger? Or might the danger rise partly out of the complexities, the contradictions of her own nature, that nature which had always so baffled and eluded him? But the doubt which lay behind this last question seemed disloyal, and he forcibly drove it from his mind. Mary Regan, he emphatically told himself, was the woman he had believed her to be. She could explain everything. Whatever might be wrong was due to the unknown other persons. Slantface's theater, though the hour was only 10, was dark. He hurried to Slantface's apartment, but Slantface was not there, and his wife knew nothing of his whereabouts. Downtown again, Clifford began a tour of Slantface's hangouts, and at length he found him standing alone at the end of the Knickerbocker bar, before him a glass of buttermilk, a slender, smartly dressed person, whose immobile, lean face was given a saturnine cast by the downward slant of the left corner of his mouth.
I saw your theater was closed, Slantface, said Clifford.
What's the matter?
Bradley.
Bradley. How could he have anything to do with closing your theater?
Bradley hasn't forgot my little part in your stunt that got him out of the department.
He just waited and laid his plans. While films were being run off and the house was dark, he had pockets picked in my place, or had people say their pockets were picked, pulled this 3 times. What with my reputation, this was enough for the commissioner of licenses, and he closed my joint.
That's pretty rank. Bradley certainly does have a long memory and a long arm.
This is a 5-reel picture and it's not all been run off yet, half growled Slantface through his thin lips. In the last reel, someone is going to get him. He sipped his buttermilk, then abruptly,
Clifford, because of what you've done for me, I've played it straight for a year. The straight game don't pay, not for me. So I'm through. I guess you understand what comes next.
See here, slant face, don't be.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.